Gods and Monsters in Dracula, The Hopes and Fears of Eternal Life. Good stuff to talk about tonight. Let's get to it. Here's a brief review of where we've been, just so you know, you have some context, especially if this is your first visit. We've talked about all these things so far, and you can see we kind of began theoretically and then moved into particular texts, mostly. So tonight we continue that with Dracula. Now, Dracula is a long, very involved novel, so I want to take you through it as quickly as I can, because there's no way to talk about it without some common points of reference, all right? So forgive me for this summary, but most people haven't read Dracula. Again, like Frankenstein, they don't need to, because Frankenstein was in the air, it was in the culture. Dracula certainly is too, so people I've talked to this week, none of them have read the novel. So let's see what the novel's about. The novel is, it begins with Jonathan Harker, who's a young English lawyer who has to travel to Transylvania. He has to meet a Count Dracula who's been buying up some property in London, and he needs to close the deal, sign the papers, etc. So he goes there to meet with the Count. It is Transylvania. It's out of the way. He keeps a diary along the way, and he comments constantly on how strange everything is. And it gets stranger once he arrives at the castle. So he meets with Dracula. Dracula's odd, but not is he's very accommodating and hospitable for a while. Until one night, Jonathan goes wandering around, and he meets three female vampires who sleep with him or not. It's all very dreamlike. We're not sure, but it's very powerful. And then he sees the Count climbing down the wall one night, and then he's like, well, I think I should leave. Of course, he can't. He's captive there. He has a fiance back in London named Mina. Mina's a very interesting and enterprising young woman. She is what's called a new woman at the time, meaning that she knows how to use this new technology called a typewriter. And this is a little bit radical for a woman to be using a typewriter, but they think it'll be okay. Her friend is Lucy. So if Mina is industrious and proper, although a little bit edgy with that typewriter thing, Lucy is the other side of that. She is clearly sexual in the novel. She has four suitors, for example, to choose from. And at one point she says, oh, why can't I just marry them all, right? So she eventually agrees to marry Mr. Holmwood, Arthur Holmwood. All right, then it starts getting weird. Mina visits Lucy in Whitby, England. There's a Russian ship that contains 50 boxes of earth from Transylvania that has been shipped there and docks, or I think it wrecks actually, and a dog runs off the ship. Anyway, I'm skipping a lot of details for the sake of getting to the point. Lucy is bitten, and they can't seem to figure out what's wrong with her. Dr. Seward is a modern doctor. He's up to date on everything. He's moved past the old superstitions, and he's like, let me take care of this. He runs a sanitarium, after all, and he says, I'll take care of this. So he treats Lucy with the means he has at the modern moment, and she does not recuperate at all. So looks like we need some old-time doctoring, a little bit of witch doctoring. Someone who knows the old ways, and that is Professor Van Helsing. So he is summoned. Lucy's chamber, according to Van Helsing, is sealed with garlic. The mother is kind of clueless, and she thinks, why should my daughter be surrounded by garlic? She removes it. A wolf comes in and bites her. Again, sorry to move so quickly here, but there's so much going on in the novel. They try to heal Lucy with blood transfusions. And we'll see that this is a really important metaphor in the book. Lucy dies anyway, but is undead. So they find her wandering around, actually with a child that she's taking back to her tomb. They call her the Bloofer Lady, as I recall. All right. So Lucy must be killed appropriately. She's still undead, still wandering around, attacking children and taking them back to her crypt. So there is a particular ritual that Van Helsing does that we're going to talk about in greater detail, because it too is a very important metaphor for the novel. Meanwhile, Mina has married Jonathan, her fiancé. He has escaped to Budapest. They meet up. Again, sorry for the quick trip through the novel. But they join with the others to pursue Dracula. They figure out that Dracula's the one who's shipped those boxes. He ships those boxes to London because he is basically invading London. That's what he's doing. And he can't exist except in the earth from Transylvania. So he has to have all these boxes. He's buying up houses in London. So he's going to invade the modern city of London, right? This is bad. There's this amazing character named Renfield, who is played by Tom Waits in Coppola's film, beautifully, by the way. We're going to hear more from Renfield. He's in the insane asylum, but he becomes kind of a foil for the novel. He, for example, allows Dracula to come into the sanitarium and to bite Mina. Uh-oh. Lucy's a little loose, but Mina is a proper Victorian woman, and now she is bitten. This is a crisis. We'll see just how deep the crisis goes. They find the boxes of earth. They sterilize them, effectively corralling Dracula, and he has to get back home. So they pursue him back to the castle, and he is eventually destroyed by Jonathan and Quincy with knives. Now, if that sounds like Coppola's film, that's because he's the closest filmmaker to follow the story. There's some license in his story, but he pretty much follows it. What is he following? He's following the novel written by Bram Stoker, an Irishman who lived 1847 to 1912. The novel was written 1897. And it is, what can I say? It is a great novel. It is a pulpy novel for the time. It's pulp fiction. It is, as I told a friend, it is Christian pornography for the Victorian era, and you'll see why. It's also mythological, and you'll see why. It's also historical, or Stoker would like for you to think it is. He goes to great efforts to kind of authenticate the novel as real, but you know this tactic. Now, you know the Blair Witch Project. Do you remember the Blair Witch Project? Right, where it's found footage, right? Same process here. These are found journals and even a phonograph. Dr. Seward is so cool that he uses this new technology that no one has called a wax phonograph. So he records part of his diary onto this. And the other piece, of course, is that Stoker is using an historical figure. Vlad the Third, or Vlad the Impaler, Vlad Dracula. Dracula means son of Dracul, and so his father was pretty much a badass too. But it is Vlad Dracula, 1428 to 1476, who has the historical reputation that Stoker is interested in. You may know he was called Vlad the Impaler. it seems that this seems to be true, that he would impale his enemies, and he had a lot, and they were right around him, some within Transylvania itself, but also with the invading Turks. He would impale them on sticks. There's a woodcut of a whole, like, just field full of his enemies impaled through the stomach while he's having dinner. He sits and has dinner among. And there's even some suggestion that he did not impale them through the stomach, but he used the other end of the pole and greased it and would put them on, put the pole into their rectum and let them gradually die through that kind of impaling. Yeah, you do not want to party with Vlad Dracula. This is also Gothic fiction, but with a twist. I put Gothic in quotation marks because it is Gothic. He's playing on that tradition that we saw last time with Mary Shelley and Frankenstein. That is the dark, gloomy atmosphere. There's almost always a castle. There's a lot of death. But he's doing something interesting because instead of setting most of the action in the castle, most of the action takes place in London, the modern city, right? So this is a kind of parody, or at least a new kind of Gothic fiction. All right. Now I want to take you back to our second lecture, which was how to make a monster. And I want to remind you of a few things about monster culture that we talked about then. The monster's body is a cultural body. What does that mean? That means the monster's body doesn't exist. It's a fictional body. So what's it made of? It's made of cultural values. It's made of cultural prejudices. It's made of cultural fears and even hopes. It's a cultural body, right? It's made of cultural symbols. It is a cultural symbol, sometimes many, in a conglomerate. Remember the etymology of the word monster, monstrum, to demonstrate, to show, to reveal, right? Yeah. Projection. Absolutely. It's a projection. It comes from inside us and we put it out there. It comes from inside our culture and we project it outward. Then we read it back. We do this individually or psychologically. We do this culturally. Joseph Campbell said, myth is the dream of culture. Same process, individual, cultural. All right. The monster is telling us something about us that we know but don't want to see. That's what the monster's body is a cultural body means. The monster is the harbinger of a category crisis. Again, don't worry about this language. It just means that the old categories that we use to understand the world, good, evil, male, female, life, death, light, dark, are failing. That's when monsters appear, when the categories are failing. We're living through one right now, democracy, authoritarianism. Those categories are pretty shaky right now in Europe and the United States. Beware of monsters. They've been shaken loose. So the monster rejects categorization. That's how the monster creates this category crisis. He won't fit into your boxes that you have for him. Dracula, is he live or dead? Well, he's both, right? Deal with that. It threatens the order, right? So you're going to see how Dracula threatens to overturn Victorian culture in all kinds of ways in terms of sex and marriage and life and death. And so the monster requires us to rethink our categories, those categories that we have so used so often that they just become second nature. We think they're real. And the monster says, you think your categories are real? Look at me. I exist outside of your categories. I exist outside of your categories. The monster symbolizes difference, the other. We talked about in that lecture how the monster is always she and them, because the stories are written by men. whether it's ancient mythology or contemporary or Victorian literature, mostly written by men, and so the other is always she, and the other is always them. That is, if you don't look like me, as a 19th century Irish gentleman, then you are other, you are them. This is my favorite. Fear of the monster is a kind of desire. The linking of monstrosity with the forbidden makes the monster all the more appealing, right? Tell someone that you can't go there. I want to go there if you tell me that. That's an old story too. It comes right out of the book of Genesis, right? When you set a boundary, humans want to cross it. We saw that last time with technology and Frankenstein. Plus, on the other side of that line, complete freedom. Who doesn't think about complete freedom? You know, the monster has complete freedom. At least freedom from our ethical codes, our societal mores, our expectations. It's free of all that. Sometimes that looks really good. Fear of the monster is a kind of desire. And finally, the monster stands at the threshold of becoming. Something's changing when a monster appears. The categories are failing. Something new is emerging. And the monster stands right there to kind of point the way. The monster is a symbol, a monstrum. He's showing us, trying to show us something. What is it? We don't quite know yet because it's still becoming. But he's standing there as a signpost. Monsters push us to our edges. And you know what else is at the edge? Is the sacred. The sacred is by definition not the everyday. And so the sacred and the monstrous sometimes look exactly the same. All right, what about this monster, Dracula? His name comes from the Order of the Dragon, or Dracul, and also the devil. In Romanian, that it means both. It means dragon and devil, and we know why now, if you've been in this series. We saw how the author of the book of Revelation made this connection to the original chaos monster, the dragon, to that ancient, that great dragon, that ancient serpent, who is called the devil and Satan. He ties them together. Now you've got, from the beginning, in, say, Hesiod's Theogony, or even Enuma Elish, you've got this dragon that represents chaos, and the author of the book of Revelation says, that old dragon is this new serpent, the devil and Satan. All right? Now, Dracula deliberately plays into that mythology. Dracula is also a god, or at least according to the novel. I think it's Harker who says in one of his diaries, "What manner of man is this?" That's deliberate religious language taken from the Gospel of Matthew. I think it's, he comes to Mina in a pillar of cloud, right out of Exodus 13:21. The descriptions of Dracula are of the sacred, along with the demonic. The monster is a harbinger of a category crisis. You think God's here and Satan's here? No. They are together. I want to mess up your categories. Nina Auerbach, a critic, says that the novel is a compendium of end-of-the-century phobias, right? So what was worrying the people of England in the late 19th century? Well, a lot of things, and we're going to see some of them in the next few slides, including immigration. They were concerned about immigrants coming into their country. Dracula as a religious other, okay? So you don't have to read three sentences before you get the sense in the novel that Jonathan Harker is going into a strange and dangerous place. He's headed east through Europe, and he keeps remarking on the differences he sees. The differences starts with the food. He has a rough night with some paprika in Hungary. He has a British stomach, so he can't quite handle it. And then the landscapes and then the people. And it sounds like a travel narrative. We have a lot of travel narratives of Europeans going around the world, starting with Columbus, but increasingly more and more with as travel was made more available. And these were a very popular genre, especially in the late 19th century. So you go, you travel somewhere, and you remark upon the differences in food, architecture, people, customs. And in fact, Transjilfa, or across or beyond the wilderness, is Transylvania. Over there, across or beyond the wilderness. So yeah, I know the wilderness. It's like Scotland, right? Now, this is beyond the wilderness. So you're in a dangerous place. You're in an other place. And Jonathan Harker, clearly in a liminal zone at the beginning, and in between. He's in an in-between space. And when we talked about ritual last fall, we saw how that liminal zone and ritual, where you're not quite what you were, and you're not quite what you're yet to be, you're liminal. Very dangerous, disorienting, troubling, exciting place to be. Timothy Beale, whose book I've used off and on in this series, Religion and Its Monsters, says that the novel is about otherness within sameness. Otherness within sameness. So he's going east where there's Christianity, but it's Eastern Christianity. It's that other kind of Christianity that the British don't know. And Jonathan is clearly uneasy, and in fact, there's not only the other Christianity, there's the other kind of superstitions. I don't even want to call them superstitions because they're borne out to be right in the novel, where the locals tell him, don't go to the castle, classic threshold guardian language, right? Don't go to that, you can't cross here. And he finally understands that they're saying the word vampire. But, you know, he's a rational man, he's an attorney. So, you know, these local people, what do they know? So yes, there's a primitive religious otherness within Christianity as well. And we know this from the history of Christianity. It built sacred sites on top of older sacred sites, right? Like Druid sacred sites in England, for example. Roman sacred sites. It would build not necessarily cathedrals, but chapels or churches right on top of the old sites. They would do that with sacred space. They would do the same with sacred time. Where they would take certain ceremonies. We're about to celebrate Easter, right? Well, that happens to be right around the vernal equinox, doesn't it? That's no coincidence. Right. Anyway, we don't want to get into that too much. We've got other things to talk about, such as Dracula as Jew. Dracula is depicted very subtly in the novel in an anti-Semitic way as a Jew. He has an obsessive relationship to money, especially gold. He is a parasite. Again, these are all ideas drawn from the anti-Semiticism of the time, which was, again, based on immigration, especially of Eastern European Jews in the late 19th century. They were parasites, they weren't morally upright, they were too interested in money. Dracula has, quote, a very marked physiognomy, a face, unquote. Again, you know this language. This is also the time of the development of, just before the development of genetics, raciology and craniology, where they scientists started studying the size of brains and stuff, and it gets really ugly very quickly. So yeah, there was a lot of Jewish immigration to England in the 1890s, and it's no accident then that Dracula has Jewish characteristics according to the anti-Semitism of the time. Who else is he? Dionysus. Oh yeah, he is definitely Dionysus. Dionysus, if you don't know, is the Greek god of excess. He is often, especially by Nietzsche, paired against Apollo. Apollo is the god of order and the rule of law and peace and the state. Dionysus is the god of the state of nature, right? Which is sex, wine. In fact, he's called Bacchus. You may have been to a Bacchus celebration. That's his Roman name. Walter Otto says that he is the god of madness, ecstasy, wine, and blood, also called the render of men because he splits men apart. He literally splits them apart. And the eater of raw flesh. This is the animal us, the Dionysian us. And if you've read your Nietzsche, you know that's who we really are, according to Nietzsche. It's not this fake Apollonian good citizen. We are the eaters of raw flesh. In fact, if you know the play Euripides' The Bacchae, this is exactly what happens in Thebes. Dionysus and his band of women come in and just wreck the place because people leave their homes to follow Dionysus and his followers. And in fact, the king of Thebes is pulled apart by them at the end of the play. So Dionysus is about the rural, not the urban. It's about living in the forest, drinking water and wine, and being naked and having sex and things you generally can't do in the urban environment, although we're in Los Angeles, so take that little caveat on that. It's about animality, just our animal selves, gender ambiguity. So the gender categories get fluid in a Dionysian scene, and like I said, women sleep their husbands, which is what happens in Dracula, and is what the issue is in Dracula, is the state of the women, Mina and Lucy. Again, feel free to stop me. I'm going pretty quickly tonight because there's so much to cover, but you can stop me anytime. So, we have the great character of Renfield, right? Renfield is a madman who lives in the sanitarium under Dr. Seward's care, and he eats insects, spiders, worms, things like that. Why does he do that? He is a zoophagus. He eats animals because he thinks it gives him life, right? He's not wrong. Theoretically, life feeds upon life, right? One night, Dr. Seward comes in and Renfield attacks him, cuts his wrist, and the blood from Dr. Seward's wrist drops to the floor, and Renfield laps it up. Dr. Seward is shocked, as any good Victorian gentleman would be, and Renfield retreats to the corner screaming, "The blood is the life, the blood is the life." Renfield's great because he's like almost like the narrator in some way, because he gives us a lot of information we would not otherwise have. And he says this, "I used to fancy that life was a positive and perpetual entity, and that by consuming a multitude of living things, no matter how low in the scale of creation, one might indefinitely prolong life." Well, we know that story, right? That's the story of alchemy, that's the story of other things about, that's the story of Taoism and how it becomes what it is. "At times," this is still Renfield, "I held the belief so strongly that I actually tried to take human life. The doctor here will bear me out that on one occasion I tried to kill him for the purpose of strengthening my vital powers by the assimilation with my own body of his life through the medium of his blood, relying, of course, upon the scriptural phrase, "For the blood is the life." Renfield's a theologian who eats insects and worms and laps up blood. He's absolutely correct. This is right out of Deuteronomy 12:23. Only instruction to the ancient Hebrews, only be sure that you eat not the blood, for the blood is the life. And you may not eat of the life with the flesh. Pretty clear instruction, right? Do not eat the blood, because the blood is the life. That's the basis of the sacrificial system in Judaism. And Christianity will later come along appropriating Judaism and say that it's the fundamental sacrifice of Jesus was his blood. See? It's all about religion, always, even if it's a vampire. So the blood is the life. Oh, right, I didn't think I was finished there. Why? Well, there's a reason for that, and I'm not going to go into it in great detail because it's pretty complex, but it's basically Mary Douglas's, British anthropologist Mary Douglas, in her book Purity and Danger, where she analyzes the Jewish purity codes. And you might wonder in the book of Leviticus why things get so weird. Like, you know, you can't eat this, and this can't touch that. And I think you know what I'm talking about. That's also where we get some of the language about homosexuality and abominations. But it's not an isolated thing about storing meat and milk in the same area. It's a whole system. It's a complete system, and it's a pretty effective system. And it is metaphorical, symbolic. So the system is this, is that as the body goes, so goes the society. Right? As the body goes, so goes the society. And so it's not inconsistent at all. In fact, it's just the opposite. When you have these dietary rules about what's going in to your body and what's coming out, all forms of what's coming out, and how you must avoid that, because as the body goes, so the society goes. You must also guard the society. And so as a society, as the chosen people, you must not marry those people. You must not do those things that those people do. You must maintain the coherence, the stability of this unique community. And you do that by guarding your body, because that is to guard the society. Right? So you can imagine, in that system, to marry someone outside the group, that's an abomination. You can't let that happen. You've made the group impure. Right? This is what's happening in Dracula. It's the ancient Jewish purity cult. Dracula is unclean. He makes others unclean. And once that happens, British society will collapse. It's exactly the same process. And so you've got this, you've got most of the book, some of the book set in a sanitarium, right? A sanitarium, which is about being sanitary in body and mind, right? We still carry that over into English. In fact, one critic has suggested that Renfield is a kind of John the Baptist to Dracula's Jesus. That works for me. I don't know if you know much about John the Baptist, but he was a wild man who lived out in the wilderness and screamed at people and ate insects. And he prepared the way for the Messiah, for Jesus. All right. The blood is the life. The blood is the sex. As I said, this is Christian porn. This is a novel about masculine potency as delivered through fluids. It's about patriarchal possession by the infusion of those fluids. Yes. Of all the horrible scenes in Dracula, and there are many, clearly the most horrific one, and this is including the character's reactions, is where Dracula nurses Mina. So I don't know if you remember this, but it is a pretty powerful scene. Coppola does it a little different than the film, but essentially it's there. There's a scene from it. Mina is bitten. Dracula visits her. He comes in through the window, and he opens his breast to her, and she sucks from his breast. Okay, what does that mean? Remember what a monster does. He messes with your categories, right? He overturns your categories. Well, there it is. The men come in through the door. Dracula comes in through the window. The men come in through the door. And they are, Jonathan, by the way, is sleeping, not sleeping, he's kind of out of it on the bed beside Mina. So Mina's husband is just laid out on the bed, kind of like out of it, while his wife drinks from the breast of Dracula, drinks blood from the breast of Dracula. The men come in and say, one of them says, "I felt my hair rise like bristles on the back of my neck." This is a mixture of maternal intimacy, sexual violence, and adultery. Jonathan is, like I said, he's out of it. Mina is kneeling beside Dracula on the bed, drinking from him. This is from the book. "His right hand gripped her by the back of the neck, forcing her face down on his bosom. Her white nightdress was smeared with blood, and a thin stream trickled down the man's bare breast, which was shown by the torn open dress. The attitude of the two had a terrible resemblance to a child forcing a kitten's nose into a saucer of milk to compel it to drink." Mina's white dress is stained with blood. His blood that is now inside her. The barrier has been crossed. The corruption has occurred. She is now unclean. And she says so. She states it. "Unclean, unclean, I must touch him, Jonathan, or kiss him no more." She is unclean according to the purity laws. And in fact, as we see later, Van Helsing tries to help her and puts a communion wafer on her forehead, and it burns off. It like burns the skin off. She's unclean. In relation to this scene, she sank on her knees on the floor after her skin is burned in an agony of abasement, pulling her beautiful hair over her face as the leper of old his mantle. She wailed out, "Unclean, unclean, even the Almighty shuns my polluted flesh." Leviticus 13:45. "The person who has the leprous disease shall wear torn clothes, and let the hair of his head be disheveled, and he shall cover his upper lip and cry out, 'Unclean, unclean.'" It's heavy stuff. Dracula's, yeah, Emily. Yes. Mm-hmm. Very good. She's born again. Reborn. Exactly. About to enter her new life. The blood is there. The suckling has begun. And in fact, a wedding has occurred. Dracula says to Mina at the end of this scene, "And you, their best beloved one, their best beloved one, are now to me flesh of my flesh, blood of my blood, kin of my kin, my bountiful winepress for a while, and shall later be my companion and my helper." It's a marriage. So it kind of all happens very quickly at the same time. Yes, bodily purity, social order is the cosmic order. The men are absolutely devastated because now the uncleanness is there. And that's one thing, the uncleanness has kind of been there. Dracula's been there. Now he's inside her. He's inside. It's, you know, Lucy was, you know, we'll talk about how Lucy's depicted not well in the novel. She was kind of looking for trouble, let's say, according to the novel. Mina was not. She was trying to be a secretary. I mean, and she was marrying an attorney. Why does she deserve this? In the repossession of Lucy, I mentioned the transfusions that the men give her. That, too, is the sex. That is a sexual intimacy, as made clear by the novel. It's a fusion of two bodies through the life, that is, through the blood. Arthur calls it, her fiancé calls it, a transfer from full veins of one to the empty veins which pine for him. Okay, the empty veins that pine for him. Lucy writes, somehow Arthur feels very, very close to me. I seem to feel his presence warm about me. Again, I'm not making this up. This is in the novel. Arthur notes that he felt since then, since the first transfusion, as if they two had been really married and that she was his wife in the sight of God. Interestingly, this is Dr. Seward now, who was also one of Lucy's suitors, and she chose Holmwood instead, Arthur. He writes about this transfusion, which is an orgy, basically. It was with a feeling of personal pride that I could see a faint tinge of color steal back into the pallid cheeks and lips. No man knows till he experiences it what it is to feel his own lifeblood drawn away into the veins of the woman he loves. Right? Wow. Van Helsing, Quincy Morris also give blood to Lucy. So all four give blood to Lucy, except Jonathan. Why can't Jonathan give blood to Lucy? Because he's already married. Right? This isn't about transfusion, this is about sex. So the married man cannot provide the blood. And in fact, they agree, Arthur gives his blood first, and they agree later that they cannot tell Arthur that they too have given blood, because that would be scandalous, right? This is ultimately, as I noted in the overview, ineffective. Professor Van Helsing is called, and he says, quote, the old centuries had and have powers of their own, which mere modernity cannot kill. This is also about modernism, right? We talked about that, modernism. So, repossessing Lucy, the transfusions do not work. The orgy does not work. What is needed is a wedding night and that kind of sexuality. Van Helsing conducts the ceremony. They go to Lucy's grave, trap her there because now she's turned. And Van Helsing says, it is out of the lore and experience of the ancients and of all those who have studied the powers of the undead that I perform this ceremony. And what is required is for Arthur to kill his bride. Bride now, because they had the transfusion. And listen to the description of the killing of Lucy, the second killing, the ceremony of death and marriage and sex. The thing in the coffin writhed. And a hideous, blood-curdling screech came from the opened red lips. The body shook and quivered and twisted in the wild contortions. The sharp white teeth clamped together. till the lips were cut and the mouth was smeared with crimson foam. But Arthur never faltered. He looked like a figure of Thor as his untrembling arm rose and fell with the stake. The sight of it gave us courage so that our voices seemed to ring through the little vault. And he plunges the phallic object into her chest. And now she has truly died. In fact, she is purified by a man. By a man sexually, because how else do you purify someone in Victorian England? The text says Lucy, as we had seen her in life, is now back with her face of unequaled sweetness and purity. Purified her. And Van Helsing says this at the death of Lucy, tells Arthur, and now you may kiss her. Right? Amazing stuff here. All right, we're almost done. Then we'll get to discussion. The way it ends, you may remember, is Mina, because she has been bitten, she becomes telepathic with Dracula, who is fleeing back because he has no home anymore in England, which is the point. Repel the invader, eliminate the virus. So he's heading back to Transylvania. It's an apocalyptic setting. It's an end-of-the-world setting. Van Helsing describes it as the area around the castle is so wild and rocky as though it were the end of the world. And Mina calls it perfect desolation. Now, Mina is not allowed to participate in the final battle because she's a woman. She's a secretary. She can type, but she can't kill vampires. The battle of, until Buffy, which is part of the genius of Buffy, but we'll get to that. The battle, of course, is joined at twilight. Sun is setting, which means Dracula is about to be unleashed from his coffin. They tear off the lid of the coffin, and Dracula smiles because he can see he's about to gain his power back at darkness. But Jonathan and Quincy emerge. Jonathan cuts his throat. Quincy stabs him in the heart. Dracula is fatally wounded and turns to dust. The corruption, the uncleanness, the invasion is repelled. How do we end a story like this? Well, we've already had a bunch of weddings, so we have a child. Jonathan and Mina have a child. Quincy dies. By the way, Quincy's from Texas, who, you know, great character from Texas, here to hunt vampires. He dies in the process, so Jonathan and Mina name their child Quincy. The goodness continues. Now, this is, if this sounds laughable, it is. It's not a great novel literarily, but it is a great novel mythologically in that it touches all kinds of nerves. The life-death dichotomy. Again, we live with these binaries. Life-death, good-evil, light-dark, man-woman. We depend upon these binaries because that's how we've organized the world. But the world keeps changing. And so we have to change our binaries sometimes. Dracula is both. He's alive and dead. He makes other people alive and dead. So it's not just one weird guy in Transylvania. He threatens the whole social order with this duality. The Mina-Lucy comparison is classic. A couple of literary critics, Sandra Gilbert and Susan Gubar, wrote a book in the 70s called The Mad Woman in the Attic and analyzed the depiction of women in literature, especially, well, British and American literature, and said that in the history of literature, women are one of two things. They are either angels or they're monsters. So this works out in Stoker's novel. Mina is clearly the goddess or the angel. Lucy is clearly the monster. That's how they end up. Lucy's a monster. There's also a lot about religion here. As I've said, It's about reaffirming Christianity. At one point, the four men, I forget how they phrase it, but basically they're Christian soldiers about to do God's work by killing this vampire. So the return of the repressed. There's, as I said at the beginning, there's an older religion at work in Dracula, and he calls upon, he says, and Van Helsing knows it. That's how Van Helsing can be successful, is he knows the old stuff that's been forgotten or repressed. So it's the return of the repressed, a phrase Freud used. Basically, like, you know, it's like a balloon in water. If you try to push something down culturally or personally, it's going to pop up somewhere else. So this is the return of that old forgotten religion, which is never actually gone. Right? The return of the press sexuality. Oh my God, this, you got to read this. It is achingly sexual and not erotic. So I don't mean it that way. It's just that so heavy-handed with the sex. The blood is the sex. And more than that, so it's the return, it's Victorian literature, so it's the return of that repressed sexuality that we know the Victorians for, rightly or wrongly. It's about culture versus nature. You know, this is the late 19th, it's 1897, we feel like we got this stuff figured out, we've developed science, we've moved past the old paradigms and the old superstitions, we kind of got this figured out, but nature... You can, what's the saying? Chase away nature and she returns at a gallop. Nature has come back. You cannot remove nature from your life. So it's the failure of modernity and the urban. Dracula says, I love your city. I want to see your city because it's a lot of fresh blood, right? So yeah, you make a great thing. We talked about this last time with Frankenstein. You create a very powerful technology of travel and architecture, and you can build a city like London, but there are always unintended consequences. There are things you can't think about, can't cover, things that are always going to come back that you will miss, like a vampire. And then, as we said, the monster always returns. That's another piece of monster culture. The monster always returns. Why? Because we are the monster.